அடுவோமே பள்ளு பாடுவோமே ஆனந்த சுதந்திரம் அடுவோமே பள்ளு பாடுவோமே ஆனந்த சுதந்திரம் அடைந்து விட்டோம் என்று ஆடுவோமே பள்ளு பாடுவோமே ஆனந்த சுதந்திரம் அடைந்து விட்டோம் என்று ஆடுவோமே எங்கும் சுதந்திரம் என்பத பேச்சு எங்கும் சுதந்திரம் என்பத பேச்சு நாம் எல்லோரும் சமம் என்பதுறுதியாச்சு சங்கு கொண்ட வெற்றி உதுவோமே சங்கு கொண்ட வெற்றி உதுவோமே இந்த தரணிக்கெல்லாம் எடுத்து ஓதுவோமே ஆடுவோமே பள்ளு பாடுவோமே ஆனந்த சுதந்திரம் அடைந்து விட்டோம் என்று ஆடுவோமே
This was composed, written by the wonderful and most important Tamil poet Subramanya Bharati sometime in the early 20th century. He speaks of freedom. Aaduvome palli paaduvome aananda sudandiram adaindu vittom endru. He says, let's sing and dance and celebrate that we have got our freedom. எங்கும் சுதந்திரம் என்பதே பேச்சு. Everybody is talking about only freedom. நாம் எல்லோரும் சமம் என்பது உறுதியாச்சு. It's been finalized, shall we say, it's been etched that we are all equal. சங்கு கொண்டே வெற்றி ஊதுவோம் ஊதுவோமே இந்த தரணிக்கெல்லாம் எடுத்து ஓதுவோமே. We'll take a conch and we will celebrate this. We will tell the whole world that we are free. Standing in front of you today, I don't know whether to believe that there is any truth in what Subramanya Bharati said. I don't know whether to wonder whether he was living in some dreamland. Because after over 70 years, this was of course written in the context of the freedom struggle, we have to seriously wonder whether that word, freedom, really has meaning in our lives. If it does, where is it placed? What do we do with it? Because if we don't ask those questions today, I do very strongly believe that our democracy is leading itself in a direction where we may forget the word, freedom. I was supposed to give this lecture last year, but because of the floods, it was moved to this year. And this is the topic I gave last year, fear in freedom. And within 1 year, I feel that the gravity of this subject has become so much more. I stand before you today when 19 lakh people, 19 lakh people have been told they don't belong anywhere. The National Registry of Citizens has yesterday sent its final list, in which we know that 19 lakh people don't know who they are, within quotes. They are told you have 120 days to appeal to what is known as the Foreigners Tribunal, and they still may have nowhere to go. Many of them have lived in this land that we call India. They have grown up here, they have friends here, they have family here, they have worked here, and they have smelt the same monsoon rains that you and I smell. They have eaten from the same paddy fields that gives us rights, the same vegetables, the same meat, the same fish and everything. And today, they don't know who they are, or they are told that. We are also facing probably one of the most crucial times constitutionally. We are faced with a situation where in 2019, a government, a democratically elected government, I have to state that, can send in an army, send in troops, arrest whoever they want, put elected members of Parliament and Legislative Assembly of Kashmir in arrest for over a month. We live in times when the press does not have free access to go and find out what is really going on. They have to go covertly, they have to hide and report. We live in times when we are all told, please hate. We are all told, be angry. We are all told, please use bad language, shout at each other. This is what we call television news today. I don't even know, considering all these signals that are coming to us, forget about your political positions or what you believe. Those, just let's temporarily, shall we say, stop, leave that. As human beings, all of us are gathered here with feelings. Do we really feel? Do we really feel like human beings, not as Indians, not as Malayalis, not as men, not as women, not as anything? Do we just feel? And I'm more and more afraid that what is the greatest tragedy of our times is we have become insensitive to even feel. We've become so numb with one feeling, and that's a feeling of hate and anger. Most people would believe that hate and anger is like the primary force of the, shall we say, the animal within us. But the primary force is not that. The primary force is another word. The word is fear. The shouting is not an example of great belief. The screaming is not an example of an understanding. The putting down the other person is not an example of actually knowing. These are all manifestations of what we actually feel, which is fear. So what we are all feeling today is fear. I am, again, the correctness of the fear, the wrongness of the fear becomes immaterial once you feel it. If somebody is scared, somebody is scared. You can argue that it is not rationally correct. You can give them information, but that is not going to go away. But where does this word fear come from? I love looking at etymologies of words, that is the origins of words. Sometimes the origins of words tell us much more than we realize. The word fear, if you look at its etymology, it has biblical connections, religious connections. And I'm going to list a few of the meanings of the word etymologically. Venerate, revere, stand in awe. And the next one is my favorite, piety. So one of the origins of the word fear is also piety. Its connections are, of course, with God, to stand in awe of the Supreme, to stand with piety of the Supreme, to venerate the Supreme, to revere the Supreme. Isn't it very interesting that this is the word we use for being afraid of something? We have to think about this very carefully. So when we, the word fear itself is so loaded with history that that feeling comes with our subservience to something, be it God or anything else. It can be anything. It need not be only God. It can be even so many other social structures. It can be even rationality, by the way. You can be subservient to rationality that you don't have even the sensitivity to understand the believer, understand faith. So both can be as problematic. And whenever we use the word fear, everybody in India will have to quote Tagore. When the mind is without fear and the head is held high. We have to. And if I don't do it today, somebody will come and tell me, sir, why didn't you quote Tagore? This is something we all know. Tagore's quote, we all know. But I should tell you that Tagore himself translated his poems into English. But with due respect to the great man, sometimes his Bangla versions were, most of the times his Bangla versions actually had something extra that his own translations in English did not bring out. Just the first line of "When the mind is without fear and the head is held high," in Bangla, it's "Chitto jekha bhoy shonyo uccho jekha shir." And there is an important difference if you just look at the meaning of the words. Of course, there are interpretations too. Chitto can be the mind, but in this context, it's the heart. Chitto jekha bhoy shonyo uccho jekha shir. He says, when the heart is devoid of fear and the head is held high. And I think there is a very important differentiation here when you think of it as a heart and not as the mind. Because all these words, you know, in India we use these words, you know, secularism, freedom, pluralism, equality, these are all words we use. The fact is, most of these words are obscure and abstract. Nobody understands what it means. Does anybody knows what secularism is? They'll give you a dictionary meaning for it, or some academic would have written some piece on it, they will tell you. Can you feel secularism inside you is the question. Fear is not an idea that you understand. Fear is something you feel when your hand trembles. Fear is something you feel when you gasp. Fear is something that doesn't allow you to sleep. Fear is something that makes you hate another person. Fear is something that makes you hold on to who you are, making sure nobody else can get on the stage when T.M. Krishna is standing here. Fear is something that makes sure, as a musician, that I compete with every singer. I make sure if that singer can stand on his head and sing, I will stand on my head and sing. Why? Because I am fearful that I will lose something. That is fear, not some word you need to understand. So when Tagore spoke of chitto, of the mind, he spoke of the heart. He said, we're looking at a land where you don't feel the fear. That you can breathe. All of you know, when you're scared, you can't breathe. You just can't breathe. You will hold your breath. You will pant. So it is here inside you. It's in your breath. It is in your hands. It is in your bones. And so Tagore was speaking about that sense of no fear. Not some intellectual understanding. Freedom is no different. But before I come to freedom, as an artist, what do I fear? You know, politicians fear defeat. That's the only thing politicians fear. That is why the polls are very important. That is why voting is important. Because the only thing they are scared of is losing on that day. Artists are not scared of defeat. One of the things we are scared of is failure. If I fail, if that song does not come out right, if the audience does not applaud, if the audience does not respond the way I have already imagined in my practice room. I have to tell you, as a musician, when artists practice, don't think they practice in some, you know, all these notions you're told, sadhana, people are in meditation. All this is partly true. There's a partly another thing happening. You know, we can hear the applause when we practice in our house. We actually hear it. Ask any performing artist to be honest and they will tell you, yes, they hear it. When we sing some phrase, there is one thrill that will happen in the practice room. There's nobody next to me because already next day evening, I'm imagining how loud that applause would be. So actually, that practice itself is a fearful exercise. It's not practice because I'm already preparing myself saying, that moment has to get that applause. I have to get acceptance. I have to be allowed to say yes. That is it. And of course, there is this whole notion of tradition. This is there everywhere. By the way, postmodernists, modernists, all of you also have this notion. You just have a different framework for it. Okay? So when people speak about, in my tradition, we do it this way, this is something many people will say. This is not just an art, they'll say it in so many other spheres of activity. What are they saying actually? They are telling you they're scared of something. But they can't tell you why they're scared. Let's forget society now. There is a fear inside. As a young boy, when I started performing, I was a very superstitious person. My mother will tell you stories and stories about it. So one of the superstitions, as ridiculous as it is, I will tell you what it is. There were two of them. One is only my mother should play tambura at the concert. Nobody else was allowed to play. Two is when I got ready for the concert, my clothes for the concert, no, kurta and dhoti, have to be placed facing east. Don't even ask me if there's any sense to it. There's no sense to it. This is the first time I'm actually saying this in public. Why? There are two things to it. One is I am so scared that that little thing, that thing I don't have control over, that mystical idea of existence is going to come and somehow destroy that evening. And my way to fight that mystical element is to do everything I have in control, which is make sure my mother puts tambura. Make sure East and West are honored because North is not a good place, you see. Even in that superstition, I have already discarded somebody. In that superstition, I have judged East and West and said North is... People tell you never put your head towards the North, there's some magnetic forces and all. Of course, it's rubbish, but many people still do it. Why? Why take the chance? Suppose it's true? Suppose I get brain fever because of that? No, I'm just saying these are funny at one level, but these are real at many levels. We operate like this. We operate, and also in the fear, you're already judging things. You're already deciding what you want to satisfy, what you don't want to satisfy. Who is more powerful, who is less powerful. So even in the functioning of responding to fear, you're not a victim, but you're also a perpetrator. And you pass this on to everybody you know who is lower in the power struggle. Caste, there is a big fear operation. It's there in every direction. If you speak to Brahmins in Tamil Nadu, they will all tell you, I mean, all is of course very dangerous to always make generalities, but all will be a pretty decent number as far as Brahmins in Tamil Nadu will be concerned. I'll stick my neck out on this one. Probably 95% will tell you that the whole of Tamil Nadu was destroyed because of the Dravidian movement. They will tell you about how Brahmins were completely pushed away, which is why they went to America and studied and made millions, of course, and about how the whole Dravidian movement has destroyed the culture of Tamil Nadu, marginalized the Brahmin community, that they are nobody today. Now, I can make 100 rational arguments to prove that this is completely bunkum. On any kind of rational argument, you can prove it. But it's not going to change this narrative. Now, where did this narrative come from? This narrative basically came from the fact of losing ownership. People who control the politics, the education, the social cultural framework, through a period of a couple of decades, politically became irrelevant. That's one. They also found many other people moving up the social ranks and taking control of multiple positions that only belong to them. In that narrative, there is a fear. The fear is, we have lost everything. We are nobody today. But if you turn around and think about a little deeper, there is a very interesting fact about the Dravidian movement. People will tell you that Periyar was the most evil person that could have existed in humanity. I think he's one of the most important human beings from South India. Yeah, I think that requires an applause actually. If anything else, that does. And they will tell you he was a violent thought. He had, in fact, people tell you there's no intellectualism in Periyar too. They tell you that. No doubt there have been stray cases of Brahmins who were attacked around the 60s and 70s, I think. But a very important fact about the Dravidian movement is not one Brahmin was killed over 35, 40 years of a social change in the whole state. Can anybody explain find a more non-violent social movement anywhere? Not one. Not one. Yes, there were some attacks, no doubt. But there was no mass murder. There was no ganging up and getting poor Brahmins in one place and killing them. That still happened only to who? To Dalits. Whether it was the Dravidian movement or before or after, they are still facing that. So just see how hierarchy operates here, how fear operates here, and how the perpetrators also operate here. They operate in so many different dimensions. The Sanskrit word for fear is bhaya. We say abhaya is free of fear. Then of course there is nirbhaya. That's a word we all now know. It also more or less means the same thing. Abhaya and nirbhaya are not very different. But you could add something to nirbhaya, which is an undauntedness, a sense of security, secure and safe. That's what nirbhaya has that abhaya does not have. The sense of being safe, the sense of being secure, the sense of being undaunted. Now, I have painted this very dark picture of all of us living in fear, all of us being fearful human beings. You may wonder for a moment, how much time do I have? I can, enough time, right? Is there a clock here? Sorry? 15 minutes? All the best to you. Where is the other word? Why did I say fear in freedom? That's how I framed the title. Because we tend to talk about these two elements as being these absolutes. That freedom is this absolute utopian idea. And fear is an antithesis of that. So they're kind of competing with each other. But I do not believe they actually work that way. Again, I'm going to push you back to etymology of the word freedom, the other word in the title. One of the old German etymologies gives you, I can't get the pronunciation, but freedom, which means free will. Just keep that in your mind for a few moments. There is another German etymology you can pick, which is F-R-I-E-D-E, Freid, or how it is pronounced. And that word means peace. And that attracts me immensely. That freedom, again, is about feeling peaceful. Just like fear is about feeling permanently threatened. It's about a state of being in equanimity, a state where you don't have to safeguard something against somebody or oppress somebody. Both are working in tandem. And to me, I find that as an interesting etymology for the word freedom. I'll bring it back to art a little bit. In art, we always talk about freedom, especially in Indian music. We talk about, you know, improvisation or manodharma, how you want to talk about it. There are two ways people see it. Some people will tell you, there is just immense freedom in this. And some people say, no, actually there's not much freedom. You know, it's very organized. You just think there is freedom. But you know what? The people who actually, audience like you, who come and say the music is so free, you know what you're talking about? You're talking about what you experienced when you heard the music. You're not talking about whether it is structured, whether there are rules. You're not talking about that. You felt that way when you heard the music happening on stage. I felt that way when I sang. I felt peaceful and liberated. Again, it's an emotion. It's something you felt when you experienced the music. So you say it is, the possibilities are innumerable. The musician was in a trance. The musician was flying. All that, whether the musician was doing or not, you were doing. You were in a trance. You were flying. You were without, you were unfettered, as they say. But then quickly somebody, the moment, especially in a social context, you say freedom, they say too much freedom is bad. Haven't you all heard this? Haven't we all heard this? Especially if you're teenagers, you've definitely heard it from your parents or your uncles or aunts or grandfathers at some point of time. Too much freedom is bad. But what is this too much freedom? Is it something that you ration in a container and say, okay, 50 kgs of it is fine. If it's 57 kgs, it becomes too much. Who's the arbitrator of this too much? The arbitrator is a person who is scared of you. The arbitrator is a person who is scared that in your freedom, that person's control over you will go away. I'll wing it back to music. This happens between every teacher and student. The relationship between a teacher and student is very complex. This happens also, for example, PhD scholars. They will tell you about the guide. The same issue will happen. I'm teaching the student of mine for 10 years of my life. He or she has been learning from me. I not only enjoy teaching the person, I enjoy the fact that I sit on the stage and the student sits on the floor. I do enjoy it. After a point, I enjoy the fact that the student needs me. Call me and say, Anna, what do I do? Okay, you can do this. That's power. That's power. And when that person suddenly starts thinking and feeling on her own or his own, my power wins. I lose the ability to control that narrative, control that individual. And how much of a liberal I may have, my classrooms are extreme. I was talking about it this afternoon. We argue, we fight, all that happens. If I lie to you and say I don't ever feel the loss of power, I am lying. I do feel the loss of power. It comes in that moment where you say, I'm not able to control that person anymore. The person doesn't call me and ask me. And that transforms to what? Anger. I'm angry about the other person's freedom. I'm angry that the person is thinking. I'm angry that the person has a different way to see things. I'm bringing multiple thoughts here. This whole Me Too controversy into this fold. Whether it is in journalism, whether it was in Carnatic music, whether it was in any other field, what we constantly hear people say, especially men and male chauvinistic women, constantly say that, one, I got a person who actually sent me a note recently saying, why are these women conveniently only talking about all this 10 years after it happened? And the word was conveniently, okay? Why did they not at that moment itself speak about it? And of course, everybody has an anecdote, right? I knew one lady who in 1947 immediately, challenged a man and got it solved. Now, if you just look at this whole narrative that you hear from multiple sections of Indian society on Me Too, where the woman is always to be blamed. She's to be blamed from the moment of first, if that person made advances, why did you go back and learn class, go to class? Without an understanding of the fear which is completely entrenched in the relationship that is being made. Say I'm a girl from a village. I'm coming to learn music to this city. My parents, I'm sure my parents would have not allowed me to do that. or would have said, you know, do you want to do it? I don't have an infrastructure in my home emotionally or socially to back me. And I go and learn from this individual and there is abuse. What kind of power control are we talking about? This is a powerful person, can give me opportunities too. If I destroy that relationship, I may be nobody. I can't go back home because I told my parents this is what I want to do. I'm just giving you one scenario. There are 100 scenarios like this. Why I'm bringing this up here is it is important for us to understand the fear. Of course, the other question happens. What happens? People can be wrongly accused. I believe that that is part of how you have to handle accusations that come. If accusations like that come against me, it is my job to handle it. That cannot be an excuse to say that women conveniently don't speak about this for many years. That just cannot be an excuse. It's also the truth. It's also the truth that this comes from the fear of the people in control who have controlled this narrative. I'm talking about socially, not specific area, all over the world. And what I'm scared of is the freedom of the survivor to be able to actually have the voice to come out and say, this happened to me. I don't want that survivor to ever have the freedom in her mind and heart to ever say this publicly. And that is what these people challenge. These people actually try to negate. You know, the other word that comes with freedom is responsibility. People always say, if there's freedom, there must be responsibility. And responsibility is interesting. Again, etymologically, it means to respond. It also means a kind of an obligation. I can word that I don't like very much. Or, I mean, obligation to what? Am I obliged to what? But I'll keep that aside. There's another word which I think is far more full of life. It's a word, an Indian word, that we have no translation for in English. It's dharma. There is no way you can translate that word in English. In Pali, it is dhamma, which my friends would say is more beautiful to say, dhamma in Pali. What does dharma mean? Can we actually articulate it? Because in dharma, there are multiple things. There's a conscience. There is a path. There is an ethicalness to it. And there is an empathy. It's a mixture of what you could call a soulful way of living. Is dharma. And the freedom that we seek is a freedom in dharma. And what fear always tells you is, do not seek dharma. Because that will destroy the edifice of my social structure, of my identity. I'm going to go back. I'm going to take another 10 minutes. I apologize for that. You can keep looking at the time. I'm not stopping, Ravi. I went back and said free will. I said one of the meanings for the word freedom was free will. Now that's such a, again, I'm not here to give you any clear picture of anything I've said because I don't have a clear picture of anything. I'm just here to mess it up for myself and maybe mess it up for you too. Free will. Now that is so problematic. Do you know you have free will when you made a choice? Choice. Is choice literally in any way devoid of anything in the environment that has been seeded into you or is in contact with you to say it was my choice? Because we speak of free will and choice, especially in the privileged sections of society, with such elan that as if it's available for free. But do we really have free will? Do we really have a choice? And I'm going to take two examples for it. Both are problematic and I'm going to put it out there. One of the many controversies that this country is talking about is conversion. That people are, Hindus are being converted into Christianity. And especially if they are from the vulnerable sections of society, conversions are rampant and soon the demography of this country from 80-odd% of Hindus is going to become 8-odd% of Hindus. I really don't know in what imagination they believe that can happen, but nevertheless they believe it. What is forced conversion? Can anybody define that for me? we take, keep aside being beaten up and asked to do something, okay? Just keeping that aside, okay? Or threatened to do something. These two things, I think we can all agree upon, is violence. So, violence of this sort, kept aside. Who am I to decide that something was forced and not voluntary? What is voluntary? Is voluntary itself come from a position of different parts of society? What is voluntary for me may not be voluntary for somebody else. If I was a Dalit living in a village where my religion did not give me belief in life, my religion did not give me the strength of emotional, psychological support that faith gives me, and if I choose to become a Christian and go to a church, yes, for free education for my children, is it voluntary or is it forced? Can anybody answer that question for me? We are in no position to answer that question. Because the agency of the person who's made that decision is always ignored. I believe that that person does not have a mind for herself or himself. I believe that person can be manipulated only because they are poor and vulnerable. I believe I cannot be manipulated because I am this privileged person who has studied and can speak in English. Isn't there such a problem in both sides of these arguments? So I know, for example, I don't know which state it is, which has passed an anti-conversion bill just yesterday or the day before. I don't know which state it is, and I don't know the details of the bill, so I'm not commenting about it. But how are we going to grapple with something like this? That's what I'm trying to put out here. Free will, choice, freedom. How are you going to grapple? There's another example I'm going to take. Again, problematic. So there was this meeting in Chennai a few years ago. It was a private gathering of people of the Islamic faith. The meeting came out from a very problematic article I wrote, which in retrospect, I realized how problematic it was. But I did write the piece, and I can tell you when I wrote the piece, I wrote it with great honesty. But it surprised a lot of my friends of the Islamic faith, and they said, "We are surprised that you wrote this piece. So can we have a meeting?" So I met about 20 people of Islamic faith, and we had conversations, and they belonged to the various sections of society. And we had this whole discussion on multiple problems within the Islamic community. I was a listener, because the point was, I did not know the insides of it. That's a fact. I was just commenting. And the question of the hijab came up in that conversation. Is wearing the hijab free will and choice, or is it conditionality? Can there be an absolute answer to this question? So one of the persons, a lady from in the group, had put out this huge argument. She said, a very, very interesting argument. She said, you know what? World over, irrespective of the culture, it's the man who decides how much skin I can show. Just think of this argument. It's a very, very, very important argument. Whether it's the United States of America, whether it is India, whether it's Pakistan, whether it's Indonesia, whether it's Australia, whether it is, I don't know, South Africa, any. It's the man who has decided a woman can show so much skin. So much skin is moral. So much skin is not moral. So the hijab gives me the right and control over my body, was an argument. And the argument was countered. Of course it was. I was listening. With the whole question of saying, okay, there are so many women who get married and their husbands force them to wear the hijab. This is also a fact that cannot be denied. Where is free will? Where is choice? Where is faith? And where is conformity? When does a person reconcile within themselves that something is their choice? When does a person say, it is not my choice, it was forced upon me? I'm talking about that individual themselves, not me or you observing. And these are things we should think about. The same thing I will put out for the ghoonghat also. It's not just the hijab. The ghoonghat that you see in many states in rural North India, where women are covering their face, where it's supposed to be a sign of the rural culture, and if the woman does not cover her face, it is a blasphemous to the rural culture. So how are these choices? So if something comes from my belief in conformity, I'm not being forced in that sense. Is it really choice? Is it really free? Or am I scared of something? I'm just putting this out. I don't have an answer to this question. I'm just putting this thought out. The most important thing about freedom itself is that it's a dream. Just like Subramanya Bharti said so many years ago, it's a dream. It's hope. So freedom actually lies in our ability to imagine. If we don't know to imagine, we can't think of a better tomorrow. If we don't have the ability to create these magical worlds in our mind, there can be no tomorrow. There can be only greater, more drudgery, more anger. So freedom actually lies in that hope. And it's a hope that's never going to be attained. You're just going to keep moving. You're going to keep hoping. Another picture will emerge. New colors will emerge. So the first thing society does is to destroy your ability to dream. The first thing society does is destroy your ability to imagine, which is what our education system does systematically from the time we go to first class. It makes sure we can't dream. So with all due respects to Mr. Abdul Kalam, Dr. Abdul Kalam, who has made this, I think, statement on dreaming. I don't remember exactly what it is. That quote I've seen on many walls in Tamil Nadu. With all due respects to him, I must tell him posthumously that I'm sorry, sir, the education system that we have does not allow us to do what you speak about. You are one of the few privileged people who were able to navigate it and did it. Therefore, I apologize to him. The fact is we don't know what it means to dream. We know what it means to suppress hope. We know what it means to suppress imagination. Unless, shall we say, the stars align perfectly for that individual, dream does not happen. Those stars have to align. And they have multiple things that go into aligning that. Of course, if there are certain things in advance, the chances are higher. Probability increases. If you're a man, if you belong to privileged sections of society, if you have cultural power, if you add it with some decent economic power, then my chances of choice, free will, moving is much higher. But there is also another aspect that I want to bring back, which is when I mentioned to all of you in the beginning that there is this experience of ecstasy in art. We spoke about that time when you are flying, when suddenly your breathing slows down and the evening seems like the longest deep sleep you've ever had, or the longest engagement with your own emotions that you've ever had. I think that's what art does. Art is also hope. Art gives you that dream. That dream that you possibly had in your home, in your quietness, is rekindled when you experience this, that's all I can call it. Because when I sing, I move my hands this way, and I feel that I've somehow touched the whole world. It's just what, 2 feet, 1 feet, 1.5 feet, but the world is in my hand. And when you feel this, your dream comes back. And that's what art can give you, that hope again. Please imagine, please dream. That's what we try. But there is this other thing. There's another song of Subramanya Bharati. Yenrithaniyum inda sudandiradaham Yenrumadiyum yengal adimayen moham Yenrithaniyum inda. It's a film song. The first line is, when will the thirst for freedom be quenched? The second line is interesting. என்று மடியும் எங்கள் அடிமையின் மோகம். When will my moham, what's the English word for moham? My fascination, maybe? Moham is slightly less. I'd say fascination, maybe, just for myself. We'll find a word later. for thraldom. And how many of you know the meaning of the word thraldom? You heard the word thraldom? State of subservience, state of being controlled. When will my fascination to be in a state of subservience go away? Isn't this such a fascinating line? The first line is, when will I get freedom? Second line is, when in my fascination to be controlled go? And again, what does our society tell us? It tells us the opposite. Being controlled is important. Being in order is important. Being, you know, like in the olden days, the teacher had this stick that if you go the wrong way, one beating is important. It's good for you. So, what is happening in Kashmir today, I think, is a classic example of that. You know, I'm going to keep aside all the 370 argument, whether 370 was right, it should be removed, it's been watered down. That's a different, let's not even go there. But I hear many people saying this, that it's good. You know, it's good. You need to send the army in, lock up these people. That's how we can bring order. Doesn't this feel like a schoolmaster telling you that you need to be beaten up so that you will be a decent person? It doesn't seem any different from that. That's what you hear people saying. You need people arrested. This is all temporary. It's okay if they can't talk to people. It's okay if they don't get medicines. They can survive. It's okay. Some struggle is important in life, isn't it? To all the good things comes after suffering. But the suffering of another person is always better than your own. But just think of what we are saying to each other today. I'm extremely disturbed. My state of mind is very disturbed. That's the truth. Because I never imagined in my limited years of living that we would reach a point when you hear a large collective of this country saying, beating up people, arresting them, everything is good. I never imagined that we will be a country where we will say, you know, that's the way we need to bring them in order. But then I realized I was stupid. Because we've always been this country. We just never said it. Now we are saying it. That's the only difference. There's another thing that is happening, is a sense of revenge. Kashmiri Pandits were chased away in the middle of the night, and this is revenge for that. Please just think of how we are thinking this way. We actually think that we're going to get revenge on people. So it's okay if people die. Then how long are we going to find revenge? Shall we go back to what happened in 1940? Shall we go back to what happened in 1860? There's going to be none of us left at the end of this revenge cycle. None of us in this room will be left. We have to think about these things. We have to think seriously about these things because we are perpetrating, we, and I say we, not just the government of India, we as citizens are perpetrating an environment of only fear. Perpetrating an environment where freedom is considered almost wrong unless you're on the right side of the political line. If you're on the right side of the political line, your freedom is treasurable. If you're on the other side of the political line, you don't deserve freedom. That is the discourse of our country today. So when people call names, people call me urban, Naxal, whatever, anti-national, what they are doing is not to me. They are convincing many that I'm a person to be hated. I'm a person who doesn't deserve freedom. I'm a person who you should fear. That is what they're perpetrating. And we are participating in this perpetration. Please remember that this, we are all participating. I'm going to say this 3 times if I have to, but we are participating in this perpetration. We have aided it, we've abetted it, and now we are also screaming at the top of our voices. You know, and then we talk about this wonderful constitution. A friend of mine gave me one of the most beautiful descriptions of freedom and structure, you know, because that also seems to be in contradiction. He said to me, and I would like to say the constitution is something like that. He said that you have a loom, the weaving loom. It's very structured. The shuttle moves in only one direction and back. The weaver has, if you've done weaving, you would know there are two, three actions, your leg and your hand, and the shuttle moves left and right, the big weave. That's all fun. If you start doing it, it's almost like a symphony. It's like a rhythmic symphony. It's like a dance that the weaver will be doing. All this is in form. But you know what is creative and what is not in form? That which is woven. That piece of cloth every time is different. The colors on it is different. The designs on it is different. That loom is the Constitution of India. We are the different designs that the Constitution can hopefully create. I have a lot more to say, but I can just go on and on. I have to sing. So I'm going to pause here. And just say two more things and finish. The freedom of one person cannot and should not mean the unfreedom of another person. So there is no cost to freedom. There is no cost. Nobody is giving up anything for freedom. Freedom is the ability to share. Freedom is the ability to realize our conflicts. Freedom, in fact, is the ability to live in a state of conflict. Contestation and conflict are not bad things. If you are able to live in it, if you try to erase something, that's when freedom dies. That's when you unfreedom somebody else. Revenge is the poison of unfreedoming anybody, any community, any individual. And when people, for example, speak about LGBT rights, when people speak against LGBT rights, and there are many still in this country who are extremely homophobic and have this very deep-seated fear of the queer community. They believe that the freedom to the LGBT community will unfreedom them. They believe that freedom will unfreedom their sexuality. I don't understand how, but they feel it somewhere. So I think it is very important, I'll end with this and say it's very important to not see fear and freedom as dichotomous opposites. We have to see them as both emotions that exist and coexist in every one of us standing and sitting here. They will always exist and coexist. So when we create a framework like the Constitution, the first thing the Constitution does is, I know both these exist. What can I do to make sure we are slightly better? And like Ambedkar says, the Constitution is just a book. It's the people that matter. You can manipulate it, you can circumvent it, you can do anything to it. You can malign it, you can do all that to that book. Those pieces of words, those abstract terms. So unless we recognize that this possibility is being given in all our lives through music, through art, through imagining, through the Constitution, to be people of Dhamma. And people of Dhamma know all this coexists. Then we start seeing ourselves with complexity. We start seeing everybody else with complexity. Irrespective of which section of society we may belong to, we have to engage with these multiple layers. We can't live in any form of absolutism, because absolutism is against the grain of democracy. Absolutism is against the grain of humanity. Thank you very much.